What's up, everybody? This video is going to be a message to all the light workers. I want you all to know that sometimes I prep these videos and I have notes for them, and today I'm going to wing it. But so bear with me. That's just please. Anyways, I wanted to talk to all the light workers who at least are on my friends list, and I'm always looking for more. One thing right off the bat is if you're a light worker and you got other light worker friends, please send them to me, because I'm trying to help y'all understand something that I call dark work, you know what I'm saying, and how dark and light work together. One of my light worker friends actually sent me something today. It was a petition to stop killing of dolphins in Japan, and the town that it was happening in is Taiji, which is T-A-I-G-J-I, all one word, Taiji, which is the word that I use to describe what's known as a yin-yang symbol, which is actually not just the symbol, it's the importance of the philosophy and the concept and the reality inherent in everything that that describes. And as I will argue at a different time on another day, that's the most sophisticated, elegant, and comprehensive and simplified. It's the lowest common denominator for existence. It really is a model for how the universe works. And all of science, even, is science is actually best when it's based off Tai Chi. Anyway, so I found out Tai Chi is this town in Japan where they're killing all these dolphins. I was like, damn, you know, maybe now I'm gonna have to change my use of Tai Chi, which is just a word to describe something, right? And another Chinese transliteration of it, if you don't speak Chinese, Tai Chi versus Tai Chi. Tai Chi is usually a misinterpretation of something called Tai Chi Chuan, which is Chinese dancing based on Tai Chi. Tai Chi Chuan and Tai Chi are usually meant to say the same things. I really think it should be called Dao Chi, but, and maybe it is. But so, lightworkers, what's up? First of all, let's not talk to the light workers. Let's talk to the people who come for the anthropology. Okay, so anthropology-wise, there's something called light work, and if you don't know what it is, then let me bring you up to speed real quick. There are the New Age is what I would call this thing, and the New Age is kind of a loose confederacy of individual collectivist movements that. To really be understood, you need to kind of go back to, I think, the 1880s, 1870s. Definitely need to look at Blavatsky and Alcott and the other people who were leading occultists of the time, and examine how they formed different secret societies and philosophies that went along with those things, such as theosophy, anthroposophy, Kabbalism. You know, on and on and on. There are various religious interfaith associations involved in that. There's a whole, just an enormous sprouting out of the fertility of globalization that was introduced with the 20th century and industrialization. Suddenly, people in the West who had only been exposed to Christianity and only could have looked for ways to kind of, like, you know, make that a little bit bigger, suddenly they were like, oh wow, look, these people have the Lao Tzu, they have Sun Tzu, they have Chuang Tzu, they get to hear about the Buddha and read the Pali Canon, they went to Tibet and found the Bartholdol, they got exposed to Hindus and Ramayana and Mahabharata and Vedas and Upanishads, and everything is just like, wow. So people are really interested in this, and they went into these other parts of the world and they started to study Eastern religion effectively, both effectively and affectively. That created a situation where Christianity was suddenly kind of separated from its bones, if you will, and the meat of Christianity over the last 2,000 years, which is its own sticky situation that needs to be addressed entirely on its own, and I'm not going to do that today, it's for another time. That thing fell off, and suddenly you were exposed to realities like Hinduism is actually the religion that informs the discourse in Christianity largely, not Judaism. Most people don't know that, but there are a lot of people who do. And so these realizations like the Buddha and Jesus almost seem to be, they seem to be largely teaching the same message, except Jesus is down with suffering, the Buddha is not down with suffering. So there's that difference between them. Jesus obviously holds to some higher power. The Buddha doesn't really necessarily hold to any higher power, although that's debatable, but it's for another debate for another time. So anyways, Western culture, bam, smashes up against Eastern culture. People get enlightened, and at cocktail parties in Britain and New York and all these other fancy places, hot topics were Eastern mysticism, and as Kabbalism spread, the reintroduction of like magical ideas into a rational positivist materialist worldview that could be taken to be animistic and influence Western people who were scientific and critical of a lot of the bullshit that had come up out of Christianity. Suddenly they were re-exposed to religious ideas and had to re-examine, as the theosophists say, the latent qualities of man and the way the universe was. And all kinds of scientific and revelatory pursuits have really sprouted out of this engagement. Just an enormous amount, really. I would say that most of postmodernism is actually birthed by this clash of worldviews in the West, and that as chic, liberal, educated people at the top of the intelligentsia ivory tower became more and more invested in studying the world outside of themselves, that their passion for spirituality was reignited. All these things were birthed, like yoga and Wiccan and pagan and new, and it's all the new age. All of it is the new age, right? So you can thank Helena Blavatsky, because really, I think it starts with her. You could make arguments for people like Immanuel Kant or someone else who, you know, was anthropological in nature and was working on some kind of like interfaith, because they're out there, they are. I believe even Charles Darwin's grandfather, Erasmus Darwin, may have worked on something like that. If I'm not completely mistaken, I have so many things swimming around in my head. It's hard to, you know, find discrete lines sometimes, unless I've just recently reinforced them. So I make mistakes with my facts, like everybody. I operate largely out of my head, and some people think that's a problem, but you don't know my head. So Rockhead, I did not give myself this name. So anyways, the Dome of the Rock shall continue. And at this point, I'm going to say, you know, so that's the anthropology. That's the background to this thing, okay? You're looking at a system of entanglement, really, where even quantum was birthed out of this experience. I'm going to tell you that and make that claim, and people, you could test that all you want, but I feel that I could reasonably show you a stream of thought that would lead you to recognize that the appeal of quantum dynamics as a spiritual platform, it falls squarely into the New Age, and it was birthed exactly by those other things. Theosophy, anthroposophy, anthropology being used as a spiritual platform for a widening of horizons, etc. Did you all hear what I just... All right, so we got that part. You're there. We're up to speed. Nod. Raise your hand if you understand what I'm saying right now. Okay, that's... I'm going to take that as a small victory. All right. So now, appeal to the lightworkers. Do we know where lightworkers have come from? No, we don't know still. All right, so students of... people like Krishnamurti and Rama, you know, not Gurdjieff, these other people who were associated with these movements in the 1800s, they had disciples and movements associated with them afterward. You got things like the Transcendental Meditation Crowd, which is like Ganjiji, and I don't even know if this is correct, but you know, if you look at people like Neil Donald Walsh, Eckhart Tolle, Marianne Williamson, you know, Deepak Chopra, you know, Dwayne Dyer, that list could go on and on. We could really get bossed on that, all right? But there's this whole, you know, like group of guys, right? And ladies, sorry, I don't ever mean to leave the ladies out. There's this whole group of persons who are all individual, but they've been influenced by largely, you know, like the same collection of masters. And the 60s kind of cauterized things. And so they got this whole like experience of the people who are now, you know, post baby boomers. They're in their 50s, 60s, 70s. And they're the crowd that kind of broke away from mainstream religion and became spiritual but not religious gurus of younger folks. So now you get boom, digital age, media, entanglement. You get the internet, obviously, is the source of all this, and what it creates is an impetus amongst people on social media to really almost kind of create their own new borders of what is religious, what's how is it, how are we defining it, what's important to it, what aspects of it are we going to keep, what aspects of it are we going to get rid of, where's the goods and where's the bads, and how do we tell between the two? And it's actually a scientific process. It's an organic scientific process. It's biointelligent. It's not really necessarily driven by a single comprehensive conceptualization by one being, although those beings are out there. We exist. So there it is. And I would say out of all of that comes something called the Lightworker Collective, which is basically, if you've heard about Shift 2012, people are anxious and anticipating. And, you know, in the teachings of the Christianity that preceded this environment where this has come out of, there was a teaching that was pervasive throughout Christianity that a special generation of bodhisattvas, if you wanted to call them that in Buddhist language, but souls that had passed their tests, they had been through their lives, they were reserved, special souls who were going to come all at once and saturate the earth at the same time and absolutely cause shift, right? So that's Shift 2012, Mayan prophecy, spiritual uprising. Let's make a conspiracy for good, right? They obviously have this, like, whatever, the Bilderberg group, you know what I'm saying, if you want to call it that. Whoever it is, the Rothschilds, yada, 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 make up some boogeyman in the closet, and that's the guy on the, you know, puppeteer string, you know, making everything black and white and laying down the law for you and everyone else, right? So that guy sucks. Everybody hates him. Okay, great. Let's all go fucking continue to buy his products. So here's the thing. There's conspiracy for good now. And it comes out of all kinds of people collectively together realizing, for example, things like neo-animism has come back into fashion. People want to think about ideas like karma, Reddit, hello, anyone. And they're down with rational animist expressions. You're not gonna find, you find very little serious complaint with Tai Chi, okay? And when you do, it's usually like from this non-duality crowd that didn't understand that the duality was the non-duality in the first place. And that's the point that I'm trying to make. Here we are, bam, Lightworkers. What's up? Hi. I'm the dude, if you haven't noticed or heard. And you haven't, because there's like 12 people who watch my show. I came to Earth to be here now and to play a special role in all of this. That's unfortunate. I mean, I knew you guys were going to be largely over this and that you weren't going to want anyone to do this, and that you would be rejecting of it. And most light workers say, congratulations, you don't like me that much. But my role in all of this is to be King Bullshit, right? And if I'm the king of bullshit and religion is bullshit, then religion isn't bullshit, right? And that's what I aim to be, is the king of religion. And I don't have to aim because I'm already sitting on my throne, okay? If you're a lightworker and you're in this world right now and you feel like you're one of this chosen generation, you're one of these people who's called to be part of the shift, I want you to listen to me like I'm the fucking emperor and you're Darth Vader, okay? This is important, alright? This is important. We cannot create the shift that is necessary by pushing ourselves to some mythical height, okay? We cannot expose and oversaturate the world to just only love and light and beauty and wonder and just positivity, whatever that is, and it's everything you like. You can't just make your whole life about shutting out everything you don't want and trying to be perfect and rosy and just be like, hey, you know what? Whatever sucks, I'm just gonna ignore it and cut it off and just forget it. Like, I'm just gonna forget everything that's bad and totally pronoia out. Everybody loves me. I love myself. I love everything. And just have a big orgy of love and light and, you know, positive abundance. Okay? This is patently, first of all, unspiritual in its application and its pursuit. If you don't understand that, please at least give me a chance to explain some things about the aesthetics of asceticism. But in the meantime, I'm asking you to please, please, please understand that the pain and the suffering that people are going through and the poor choices of expression that are not ones you like are not things that you need to discard or get rid of or try to make the world free from. There are things that the world definitely needs to be free from. There is definitely some great conspiracy for evil out there. It's very real. It's very, very, very in your face, and it's very obvious who it is and where it's coming from. And we are not going to defeat that thing or save any kind of humanity or preserve any future for children or make the world a better place that we can come back to in our next life by bliss ninnying out, if that can be used as a phrase, and just, you know, gorging ourselves on good vibes. And I'm sorry to have to say that to people, but this work is going to take something more than just let's enjoy ourselves in each other's company and forget everything that we don't like. I understand that people believe that if there's a saturation point of folks who do that, that the world will just automatically transform. I understand your line of thinking. It's a decent play. And I'm not saying that people who love everything and do good all the time aren't what's needed or that they can't, you know, have a beneficial impact on the world at large. But what I am saying, okay, what I am saying is that there are things that help and there are things that don't help. And one of the things that doesn't help is setting standards that are so high, none of the real people have any interest in even trying to meet them, all right? Becoming elitists or shutting off the people who can't understand the glory of your point of view is not going to help you. It's not going to help them. I see this from people all the time. I'm a positivist now, and so anyone who makes me feel negative, I'm just gonna get rid of that motherfucker. You know what I'm saying? I have a list of in my ward section on the Institution of Non-All's Facebook page. We have a list of other Facebook pages that have blocked us from making comments. And we don't dislike them. We actually leave them in our featured like stream because I still monitor their pages. I still keep track of their information. And I still care to see what they're doing. And I have, you know, I don't care. If they don't want me to comment, fine. If they don't want us to come. Anyways, this is tailing off into my own egotistical rant. So, like, forget it, people. You can't. There are things you cannot do. One of them is you cannot separate light from darkness. You cannot separate your ego from your non-ego. You cannot separate your individualist nature from your collectivist necessities. You have to learn Tai Chi. You're going to have to learn to manage both. You're going to have to learn to manage your shadows and your shade and your moonlight and your starlight, your sunlight and your artificial light and all of these other, you know, phony lights. You're going to have to understand that things like love are painful. Childbirth is painful. Raising kids is painful. It's hard. It's difficult. It's dangerous. It's risky. And there are inherent problems in it that humans have gone through for all of their expansive time on Earth. Their strategies need to be employed, and those strategies exist. They're out there, okay? And so understanding, for example, why conservatism works. I hate conservatives. I am not a conservative. I think conservative ideology is a clear sign of absolute spiritual and moral decay, okay? Yet, what conservatives do with their religious components to maintain a pure and healthy and functioning society is the only reason that their rotten, cancerous, disgusting politics are still part of the public discourse, because they can maintain those things with their strong social bonds. And not understanding this is a mistake. Everybody trying to go it alone is a mistake. Lightworkers, you need to unite, and you need to come up with collective platforms that matter and make impacts. They can't just sit around and feed everybody's desires while you talk about other people shedding their egos, which there is a ton of. So that's what I'm trying to say. Tai Chi, light and dark, you know, we need more heavy workers and less light workers. You understand what I'm saying, people? Anyways, those without ears, you can hear it. And if you can't, you know, vaya con Dios. I don't know what else to say.